I'm thinking we should proceed if Anna and Stephen are agreeable. We'll see if Andrew manages to join us. Is he coming? Okay, hang on. Breaking news here. I'm feeling like a TV host with breaking news, and maybe Andrew is in fact joining us. Okay. Scratch contingency plan with my apologies. Apparently Andrew is on his way and will be with us shortly. I might start my intro spiel in the interest of keeping the process moving, and maybe to talk a little bit about the sort of mechanics of things, especially before we start. My name is Mark Winfield. I'm an associate professor of environmental studies here at York University. I'm also a co-chair of the Sustainable Energy Initiative and one of the coordinators for the Master in Environmental Studies Juris Doctor program that the Faculty of Environmental Studies offers in conjunction with Osgoode Hall Law School. And this seminar is being presented on behalf of the Sustainable Energy Initiative and also the MES JD program. And it's also a production of what we've christened ourselves the ENVS 6178 Working Group on Environmental Assessment Reform, which is my graduate course in environmental policy. And this event came from a number of different sources within the course. We have an experiential education component where we make interventions into active public policy issues. And one of the issues that we began thinking about was environmental assessment reform. We were, for those of us who live in the environmental assessment universe, we were, I think, shocked at the level of attention, although perhaps not given recent events, given to environmental assessment issues at the federal level in the Liberal platform, the NDP platform, and then the subsequent mandate letters and throne speech from the new Liberal government. And the federal government's announcement of an interim assessment process kind of prompted us even further in February to think about what could we do around this, and could we facilitate informing the conversation in some useful way, particularly to bring some voices together from across Canada around where this is going, what the implications of the interim process are, and where we go from here. And that in part then led to a discussion among our little group that how much did we want to focus on environmental assessment reform per se versus how much on the political economy of energy and the environment and climate change. And the answer we arrived at in effect was both. That the two, at least in the current context, have become intimately connected. That rightly or wrongly, environmental assessment processes have become a kind of proxy forum for larger conversations about the future direction of energy and environment and climate change policy in Canada, and also the role of Indigenous people in those processes. So what we did, and I must emphasize that my students did most of the legwork around this, was to bring together a panel that could provide a national perspective on these issues. Because these are now issues that stretch from British Columbia to New Brunswick. We were very, very, and we couldn't, we realized we didn't have the budget to do that physically, much as we would have liked to bring everybody here. And so we did the next best thing, which was to see what the technology in this room could do for us. And we were very, very pleased on the basis of what was really a very narrow window of availability in this room that everybody we approached said yes immediately. Hint of the timeliness of the issue. I must say, we've worked very hard to bring an Indigenous perspective into this conversation as well. And we were met with a lot of interest, but also a lot of conflicting schedules, which ultimately defeated us in that effort. Before I introduce the first speaker, a few logistical notes. The technology we're using in the room today is fully interactive, so speakers can hear and see each other in the audience and vice versa. I do remind people that we are webcasting. Indeed, we have an audience, I think, of about 40 in the cybersphere watching as well. So keep in mind that the universe will hear what you say, that we will archive the panel session as well, and post it on the FES YouTube channel. For those of you who are in the studio, if you want to speak, and for the people who are watching online to hear you, you have to press the button on the little unit in front of you, and the red light will come on, and that means your microphone is live. That's also a warning that if the red light is on, your microphone is live. So everybody will hear you. If you are watching the webcast, you will see at the bottom of your screen there's a little icon for chat. And if you click on that, that will open a little window and you will be able to submit questions in writing, which will come up for me on the screen here up at the front. And you want to address your questions to SLH120E. You'll see there's a list of the participants on the window, and that's the one that directs questions to my screen. Our discussion is going to proceed in two phases. Professor Andrew Leach from the University of Alberta will give an opening address, and we'll follow that with a question and answer session with the audience here in the studio and online, and that should run until about 2. We'll then move into a panel discussion, and I've asked each of our speakers, Anna Johnson, Stephen Hazell, and David Coon, to make some opening remarks of 10 to 15 minutes. And then again, we'll move into a question and answer phase. I understand Professor Leach can remain with us for a bit of that discussion as well. A couple of thanks before we start. First of all, to my students in the 6178 EA Reform Working Group, Adrian Debbie, who's down at the back there, Joseph DeCito, Kristen Howe, Thomas Kouanye, Adam Jones, and Sophia Santini. Michael O'Reilly here in the studio for his technical support and wizardry. When speaking to my students over the past year, I find myself describing it as a year of game-changing events around energy, around the environment, and around climate change policy in Canada. We've seen President Obama's rejection of the Keystone XL pipeline, Ontario's decision to join the Western Climate Initiative, really the California-Quebec initiative, cap and trade system, the election of the Trudeau government and the departure of Stephen Harper. But given all of that, many argue that the biggest game-changing event of all was what happened in Alberta with the arrival of Rachel Notley's government last summer, where in effect what had been from the beginning of the climate change conversation in Canada, the veto state, became a leadership state. And it's in that context that I'm pleased to introduce our first speaker, Professor Andrew Leach, who is an associate professor and academic director of energy programs at the Alberta School of Business at the University of Alberta. He holds a PhD in economics from Queen's, and most importantly, was a very significant participant in the transition that has occurred in Alberta over the last few months. His capacity as chair of Alberta's Climate Change Leadership Panel, which then effectively laid the groundwork for Alberta's climate change strategy. And with that, I'm hoping that we've got Professor Leach ready to go.
I hope so, Mark. Can you all hear me okay?
Yes.
Oh, perfect. Okay, well, thanks everybody for doing this, and thanks, Mark, for pulling it together, and apologies for my own delay in joining you, I had a little bit of a time zone mess up, which I guess is to be expected on a national panel like this. And thanks to Sophie for the invite for this. So what I thought I'd try to do with you today is talk you through where we got to in Alberta, what the process was, but also what some of the challenges were, how that relates to Canada's national challenges coming forward, and then a little bit into the depths of the pipeline question and how we see that in some ways as a proxy discussion, but also how I would think about us being able to integrate some of the challenges of climate change into the environmental assessment for pipelines. So Mark gave a pretty good intro of where we ended up in Alberta. I got brought in, I think, maybe 7 or 8 days after the election of Premier Notley and the NDP government, with a pretty open mandate that was essentially to build a credible climate policy in Alberta. We had a couple of other bits to that, which were to enhance the share of electricity supply from renewable power, to improve energy efficiency programming, and to look at the accelerated phase out of coal power. But beyond that, we had a really open mandate, which is, as I said, to bring credible policy into the province. And as Mark said, the province has a little bit of a mixed history on this file. So while it was often seen as a barrier to national action on climate change in some lights, it was also the province which had the first and most comprehensive carbon pricing strategy, or second most comprehensive carbon pricing strategy next to BC. Depending, and you know, we can look at that file in different ways depending on how you come at this. But when we sat back, we looked at the challenge for the province as we framed it, I think is actually quite parallel to the challenge that the federal government has right now. Is that if you look at how people frame Alberta, people were looking at Alberta and saying, why can't you meet emissions reductions of 20, 30, 40, 50% below 1990 levels on timelines of 2020, 2030, which when you translate them to emissions reduction policies would translate to some of the most stringent emissions reduction policies put in place anywhere in the world. And if you look back, and Mark referenced Prime Minister Stephen Harper, one of the first things that we wanted to avoid, and this will sound funny to many of you in the room and many of you online, we wanted to avoid what happened to Prime Minister Stephen Harper on the greenhouse gas policy file in part. So those of you that haven't followed this debate for a long time probably won't be as familiar with the Turning the Corner plan. If you're not, go back and look at it. The Turning the Corner plan is arguably the most stringent greenhouse gas policy ever proposed in Canada. It would have required a carbon price of up to $70 a ton on industrial emissions. It would have required carbon capture and storage in all new oil sands production facilities. It had the coal phase out, had significant support for renewable power. It had a bunch of other dimensions. And this was brought forward during the first Harper minority. And will surprise you, if you want to read the speech, go back and read the speech that Prime Minister Harper gave in the UK in May 2008 or June 2008. It'll surprise all of you. But what happened after that policy was introduced? Are you still hearing me okay? Perfect. What happened after that policy was introduced was it became clear that it had support of approximately 7 people because the environmental groups felt it didn't provide a significant enough cut in greenhouse gas emissions. Business community felt that it imposed too stringent a cut on their activities, imposed too high a cost on the economy. And people in general were skeptical because it contained mostly industrial policy and didn't get to some of the things that we wanted in terms of, or that they wanted in terms of reductions in output or reductions in emissions. And it left a really big gap. And that's kind of what we found in Alberta walking in was, we had a government previously which had put stringent targets out front, and that the policies to meet those targets were almost out of scope with what any government, not just Alberta's government, but I think any government in Canada would be prepared to impose. And so just to give you a flavor of that, the STELMAC targets, which were almost universally panned, were targets that were based on carbon prices, roughly take BC's policy and multiply it by 4 or 5 and complement it with some other additional policies. So if you look at that gap, and I think this is what I wanted to get to with this example, the gap between what we think of as politically acceptable or credible climate policies and what we think of as credible or politically acceptable outcomes from those policies, both provincially and nationally, presents a huge gap. So what we walked into was a big challenge of how do we get from this conversation about targets for which the policies are likely politically infeasible to a conversation about what policies are we expecting to impose and what would those policies mean. And I think we managed to do that reasonably well in Alberta by looking at what are comparable jurisdictions putting in place and how could Alberta put in place a similar policy. And so I'm going to pivot from there a little bit to what that means for the federal government and then go from there to what I think that means for the pipeline file. So the federal government faces much the same challenge. You have a target on the books that has been universally panned as weak, the Harper target of 30% below 2005 levels by 2030. However, if you look at the modeling that's done by a variety of groups, as to what it would take to accomplish that emissions reduction, it's roughly on the order of somewhere between $120 to $150 a ton, depending on your modeling assumptions. So put that into perspective, it's take BC's policy again and multiply it by 3 to 4 times. So if you think of BC's policy as a credible policy, it's a policy which would not come close to meeting, if applied nationally on every ton of emissions, would not come close to meeting what we've panned as weak targets. And you saw this very early on with the first few news conferences that Canada's Minister of Environment, Catherine McKenna, gave, where she was asked repeatedly, what will you do on targets? And her response, of course, is, well, we're going to use the Harper targets as a floor. We're going to do better than the Harper targets, etc. But that those statements become a challenge at the federal government level once you start to translate those particular commitments into policies. Once you start to say, what are we going to do in terms of getting that price on carbon or the equivalent policy at the levels of stringency that we need to meet those greenhouse gas emissions reductions. So how do those two pieces of information translate and move us to this question of the pipeline file or the environmental assessment file? Essentially, this file or these activities have essentially become a proxy fight about, as I see it, about that gap, that the policies we have in place are not stringent enough to meet our targets, and we don't think, even if they were, that those targets are stringent enough. So what we have is a limited set of other options through which the public can express their desire about what they think the Canadian economy should look like. And pipeline and environmental assessments provide that avenue. It provides a vehicle for a proxy fight about greenhouse gas policy and the stringency thereof. And that's really what they've become probably since the Northern Gateway file and all the way through Keystone XL, and now into Energy East and the Trans Mountain expansion. And you see a parallel story on the front of LNG, although I'm not going to talk as much about LNG. And so for me, I'm going to tell you a little bit about how I see that file and why I actually see the environmental assessment as the wrong place to address greenhouse gas emissions and how I see it as being the right one. If we want to talk about environmental assessment and greenhouse gases, the question comes down to how much is too much? And that, for a small economy like Canada's, is a very difficult question to ask. And for an industry within a small economy, like the oil sands industry, for example, that becomes an even more challenging question to ask. And many of you will shake your head and say, oh, but I know what the science says about what share of global reserves need to stay in the ground, or what share of the oil sands need to stay in the ground, or what have you, under a 2 degree scenario. But actually what you see if you look very deeply into the papers doing this is that there is a lot of uncertainty over this question. The paper that gets most often cited recently is a Nature paper by McGlade and Eakins. And the McGlade and Eakins paper essentially tests what would be the production of oil sands under a global constraint to meet 450 ppm or 2 degrees C. What do they find? They find that oil sands basically shuts in entirely within the next 4 or 5 years under that scenario. And so that result's been out front and used in a lot of different ways to say, this is clear evidence that approving pipelines to move oil sands product is inconsistent with a 2°C world. Unfortunately, the results are nowhere near as consistent as that analysis would suggest. If you look through previous work, including work by the same authors, you'll find 2°C scenarios that have, if you look at the International Energy Agency's work, 3 to 3.5 million barrels a day of oil sands, so 50% more than we have now. If you look at other work by McGlade and Eakins, up to 5 million barrels a day of oil sands, depending on what your technology assumption is. So you're talking about error bands in a 2° world for what oil sands production would look like of plus or minus about 200%, a really wide range in terms of being able to set policy. Boil it down further to the question of one individual pipeline, and you lose the ability to, in any credible way, say this piece of infrastructure is or is not consistent with a 2°C world. You have a little bit better ability to say that about Canada's national greenhouse gas emissions targets, but even at that point, you're prioritizing some emissions over others. I think we'd all agree in the room that it's probably not going to be cost-effective greenhouse gas policy for governments to decide to cap, for example, the number of license plates we issue. The logic of carbon pricing there is we're going to put the price in the system so that the highest value uses come to the forefront, not just those who are lucky enough to be in the system at a particular date. And there's a huge risk of doing that with energy infrastructure in the same way. So how do I think we solve this problem? I think you solve this problem through using the mandate that's already in place with the National Energy Board. National Energy Board's first and primary responsibility is a needs assessment. The question of, is this pipeline needed? Is it going to be full? Is it going to be used not at the expense of other regulated infrastructure? And that question provides the perfect avenue to assess greenhouse gas emissions policy. Unfortunately, we haven't used it. And the question that I think we should be asking is, in an environment where the policies are in place for Canada to meet its targets, and we assume that the global policies are in place to meet global targets, is this pipeline going to have a market? And the answer in most cases is going to be dependent on your assumptions of how those policies are imposed and how the market responds to those policies. And that's the natural role of the National Energy Board, in the same way they've historically done this for oil markets assessments for the needs of new pipelines going to different markets. And so that's always been the way that I've seen, and I've written a little bit about this, that I've seen the role for integrating greenhouse gas policy decision into our major infrastructure approvals is through the markets assessment. I'll give you a quick example as to why I think this works well. If you had a company come forward with a pipeline and they said, for example, here's our market analysis, and this is based on an oil price forecast of $250 a barrel. That would be laughed out of the room. That would not be deemed admissible. It would be challenged on cross. It would be eviscerated through the process. However, to date, what we've had implicitly and explicitly in pipeline applications are assumptions based on no further action either nationally or globally on greenhouse gases. And companies should be free to make those assumptions. They should just be able to be challenged on those assumptions. So if a company wants to come forward and say to the National Energy Board, I'm pitching a new piece of infrastructure, I think it's in the national interest, and I'm convinced there's a need for it, under the assumption that nobody acts on climate change here or elsewhere, we'll go too. And interveners, interest groups, and market participants should be able to challenge them on that basis. And that provides a much more solid footing for a challenge than a question of whether a particular pipeline, which will account for a small percentage of national or global emissions, is or is not directly consistent with a 2°C world. That's something where no matter how often you appeal to scientific studies, you're unlikely to be able to get to any degree of certainty with respect to whether a particular incremental quantity of emissions is going to have a material impact on climate change. But you absolutely could get there in terms of whether the market would still likely exist for that pipeline under what you assume is a credible greenhouse gas policy. And so what I'm most interested for this, and what I think will be most fascinating for me and hopefully for the other panel members, is your reactions, your questions, your thoughts, etc. So I've talked now for probably long enough to give you a sense of where I come from on this and where I think the world needs to go and why, and where I think our national policies need to go and why. I think it's probably the best use of all of our time right now if I open the floor to you, and that will give me some time to give you some longer answers to your questions, as well as involve more of you in the discussion. So without any sort of further rambling from me, I hope that's an interesting conversation starter for the day, and look forward to your questions and comments.
Very good. Thank you, Andrew. That's a very interesting start to our conversation. I'm going to invite people both in the room if they have questions, and also those online to use the chat function on the screen. If you'll see there's an icon at the bottom, and you want to address any questions to SLH120E on the list of participants, would let you be able to send in a question. So do we have questions here to begin with? Yes, and here. Need to press, yes.
Is that correct? Did I do it right?
Yep.
My name is Lee. I think I would have to disagree with Professor Leach's straw man construction. The opposition to pipelines in this country is longstanding. I worked as an environmental assessment practitioner since 1970. We've always had opposition to pipelines, almost certainly every single time on the basis of the project itself. Look at the Mackenzie Valley. Look at any pipeline that's ever been proposed. So to say that it's a surrogate for climate change policy, to me, is kind of crazy. It was a bit off the wall. So I'd be interested to hear his Professor Leach's response to that. Thank you.
So to be clear, I think it has always been opposition to pipelines at the project level. There are always going to be landowner issues. There are always going to be local risks. But the relationship between the pipeline, so the topic of interest today is the inclusion of upstream emissions, in particular upstream activities, and the opposition to pipelines tied to the products they would transport and the production of the products they would transport. So if you interpreted me as saying there has never been anyone opposed to a pipeline until somebody proposed Northern Gateway, then you've misheard my responses, or you've misheard my remarks. I wouldn't say that. I would say that the discussion about, and perhaps you can enlighten me, but in terms of the volume of interventions to the National Energy Board with respect to upstream impacts, in terms of the legal challenges to the NEB's jurisdiction over upstream emissions, in terms of the inclusion of a greenhouse gas test, all of those factors come in with respect to either the presidential permit on KXL or with respect to the Northern Gateway hearings to the NEB. And so far as I know, none of those were present on Mackenzie per se. They weren't present on Clipper to the same degree. They weren't present on Base Keystone.
Good. Brief follow-up.
Yeah, just very briefly. A lot of the issues that you raised are really the result from the watering down of the EA process by successive governments since the very early days, 1970s. Ontario arguably had the best EA assessment procedure in the world when it started, and it's been watered down and watered down and watered down. I worked on the federal process before it was even a process. It was still, what was it, Louise, a cabinet order or something like that in the early days? We arguably did one of the best federal EAs ever done in this country on the Pola Gas project. At least I've heard people say that. I was one of the participants in that EA. So the problems that you cite are because of Stephen Harper's and his predecessors' watering down of the EA process. We used to look at alternatives seriously on every project. We didn't just have a trumped up, well, we kind of trumped up alternatives, but we did have to look at them seriously, and we had to defend it in hearings which don't happen anymore. So I'd much rather hear a discussion around the failings of the EA process per se, how it's turned into a cash cow for big engineering firms, basically. It's a checklist procedure which has no substance, has no teeth. It's done by Dr. Google instantly instead of thoughtfully approached the way we did in the early days. I know this sounds a bit curmudgeonly, and it probably is, but the fact of the matter is that we did have in the early days absolutely superior EA processes and activities in this country, and now we have almost none of that left, and that really focuses on EA itself. It's not to do with climate change. It's not to do with energy policy. It's to do with the fact that EA doesn't work anymore. You look at the NEB, it's hilarious, you know? There's a 10-page application to apply to intervene in an NEB process. I never heard of such a thing. In my day, you could write a letter and appear before the NEB. So, the processes themselves have been watered down and watered down and watered down by governments, usually at the behest of corporations, of course. Corporations are trying to make their lives easier. So what we need to think about is whether, A, the EA process itself is now adequate, whether its goals and objectives are adequate. I would argue even more vociferously that it's not. It does not begin to incorporate social concerns. The fact that you don't have Aboriginal people here is shocking, although I understand why, because the U of T is having a big two-day event on Aboriginal things. I was just there. So that's why the people are all there. We maybe should go and talk to them there.
They're, as it turned out, in many different places.
Well, no doubt, but most of them are there at the U of T in these 2 days.
Yeah.
So, or many of them, sorry. Yeah. Obviously, not most.
Andrew, do you want to comment, or I can move to the next question? We'll save that also for the panel discussion too.
Yeah. I'd say let's leave this to leave that as it is and move on.
Good. Further questions? Professor Scott.
Thanks, Andrew. I have a question about whether or not you think there's a relationship between the two kinds of questions you're talking about. So you're saying to us, instead of making an argument around whether or not a project will increase greenhouse gas emissions, we should be thinking of making or asking this question about whether there's a market for the project or the product. And I'm wondering about the way those questions might be interrelated. So for example, if the proponent is able to make out the case that there's a market for their project, the pipeline is approved, doesn't that then just make it even harder for the governments to implement the kinds of greenhouse gas emission policies that you say are already not feasible, right? So once it's the idea that once we have the project, we then create a market for it, right? So we just increase the costs of actually implementing the greenhouse gas emission targets that we need to get to.
Yeah, and I think the fundamental element of what I'm putting forward is that we have to have within that assessment, not an assessment based on the policies we have in place today, but an assessment based on the policies which would allow us to meet either a level of policy stringency that we think is credible or a level of emissions reduction nationally that we think is credible. And so you'd be doing the market assessment under that assumption. And so what that does, I think, and your point's well taken, that one of the reasons that we have a challenge in seeing emissions reductions from our policies today is because of infrastructure lock-in, not just pipelines, et cetera. Pipelines are a little bit of a particular case in this, but certainly because of buildings, houses, vehicle fleets are a little shorter lived, and industrial processes. Pipelines are a little bit different than this, though. If you want to strand a resource, one of the most effective ways to do it would be to have an overbuilt pipeline infrastructure, because an overbuilt pipeline infrastructure translates to higher transmission costs, not lower transmission costs. And if you want to see some evidence of this, go back to 2009, 2010, when actually a lot of the oil sands companies sued the U.S. FERC, not for allowing too few pipelines, but for allowing too many. and in the context of the application of the Alberta Clipper and the base Keystone, that there would be too much transportation infrastructure and that that would therefore lead to too high a tolls and would lead to excess transportation costs. The other nice example of that is actually what's going on the natural gas main line right now, where you've had toll escalation through 2010 to 2013 that essentially ended up with more than a tripling of, or close to a tripling of product tolls because you had an overbuilt pipeline infrastructure. So there's the interaction of the pipeline regulatory function and the markets isn't quite the same as you would have if you said, think of building a highway, right? Think of building a highway and saying, well, people are going to drive on it. And the fewer people drive, the cheaper it gets to operate on that highway. Think of a pipeline as a piece of infrastructure where the cost recovery of, on the operating and capital cost of that pipeline is divided by the number of users. And so as you decline the number of users or you overbuild capacity, it becomes more expensive to ship each barrel. As it becomes more expensive to ship each barrel, you're going to produce fewer barrels, which leads to lower utilization on your pipeline, which leads to more expensive transportation cost and what the NEB is often looked at as a downward spiral of regulated infrastructure.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions actually coming in online, so I'm going to take one of them. This is from Adam Scott, who's with Environmental Defense, who's wants to thank Dr. Leach for his perspective. We at Environmental Defense have advocated for a similar use of a needs assessment of the NEB as part of the overall climate test. More detail can be found at climatetest.org. The question is for Professor Leach, you argue that a national carbon price is the ideal way to manage GHG impacts of energy projects in Canada. However, at the moment, no such policy exists in Canada, and there is no obvious pathway for Canada to adopt a national $150 a ton carbon price or something in that range. In the interim, while major projects are being proposed with no national policy on the books, how do we deal with pipelines? How do we make decisions absent the presence of that policy?
Well, I think that's implicit within what you use as the basis for your analysis and your needs assessment. So $150 a ton is the price that right now is estimated to meet the Harper targets. I think what you'd want to have is a conversation, and we can have that conversation now, but what is the appropriate price to build into that? Is it a social cost of carbon? That's the one I'd probably gravitate towards. Use a central case of the EPA's social cost of carbon and say this reflects where global policy would have to get to internalize that externality. You could also use a global price marker like the price implicit in a 450 ppm scenario to say this is building in the price we would need to meet global goals. And really importantly for this, interacting that with oil prices. So making sure that you don't have an oil price scenario that is inconsistent with your climate price scenario. And so that's how I would see it coming about. I think you still have to meet that that in some way. You still have to have some assumption of a carbon policy in your needs assessment. It's just right now we're allowing people to do it with zero. And I think zero is the suboptimal way to do it. The question I put back, and you know, we've been back and forth on Twitter a few times, I think, over this, but you know, the question I would put back is, you know, the same thing of not having a national carbon price. We also don't have national policy to meet our carbon targets. And the idea that that would be only a policy about pipelines, or that we would know any more about what that regulatory or other type of policy to meet those targets would look like and what it would mean for various infrastructure, I don't think we have that information either. So I'd argue we have probably a better ability to build some price into the analysis than we do quantities or specific infrastructure assumptions.
Were there questions? Yes, here.
I have a question about the role of public participation in this discussion around upstream impacts. So I appreciate your point that it's difficult to calculate the impact of a pipeline on GHG emissions, but it also seems difficult for public, not so much experts, to discuss issues around market access or to try to guess what these future policies might be. So I'm wondering what you see the role of the average person wanting to participate in these policies and around this discussion of upstream impacts?
I think to me it comes back to one of the things that we've allowed ourselves to have for a long time are two parallel conversations about carbon policy. We've had a conversation about targets and we've had a conversation about the mechanisms to achieve them. And they've been separated by a long shot. So I think one of the advantages of doing this is the public participation would have to involve more discussion of the actual policies which would be imposed as opposed to an abstract discussion about targets and how we add up particular pieces of economic activity or jurisdictional emissions or what have you. The other thing we've seen significantly through this discussion is almost a pie dividing contest of our public engagement is going to be on the level of determining what is the appropriate level of emissions, not just at the national level, but at subnational or industry levels. And I think that's a discussion where, depending on the rules you apply, you're going to come up with very different answers. But what you're going to have a really challenging time getting to is any clear evidence or scientific evidence or what have you of what the right division of emissions is. Because climate science doesn't tell us anything about that. It doesn't tell us, in fact, it tells us exactly the opposite. It doesn't matter where the emissions come from. What matters is the global quantity of emissions and the time path of those emissions to get to an eventual concentration. So you're into a world of more ethics, morality, distributional impacts than you are into one about climate science and climate impacts and climate change. And so I think that's always going to be a challenging topic for public participation because it's going to be much more about framing of arguments, ethical, moral arguments, than it is going to be about something where I can put better evidence on the table with respect to one argument versus another. Does that get your question or not quite?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, because I think we tend to look over this question of distribution of burdens in this conversation, particularly in Canada. I mean, the European Union spends a lot of time explicitly talking about how do we distribute the burden in terms of reducing emissions. And so far, we've kind of talked around that in the Canadian context. I mean, it did strike me, though, in terms of the NEB process, in a sense, you'd almost end up with two further processes because I think you'd end up having an argument over what would be the appropriate oil price to assume in a needs assessment? Mm-hmm. And what would be the appropriate carbon price to assume in the needs assessment? And that could be a very interesting conversation. I'm not sure if the NEB is quite prepared to host it yet. But that would be where we would have to go because it's going to be, as you say, it's a function of both these things. So the function is this viable with oil at $40 a ton, a barrel as opposed to 100? And is it viable with a carbon price?
Mm. So, you know, Mark, I think that's the right, that's exactly how I see the discussion. I think what's important to note is that's the discussion they have now, except the way they have the discussion is a little bit of discussion about oil prices, little to no discussion about carbon prices. And so we allow the assumption of zero on the carbon price front to go through unchallenged. And even insofar as we use oil prices, they're generally oil prices that are derived from forecasts that are making bearish assumptions about global carbon policy. I don't think this is going to be something where you're going to find easy universal agreement on what these relationships should be for a couple of reasons. One, what do we assume about global action on climate change is going to be a challenging assumption. And two, the interaction between those actions and oil prices isn't by any means obvious at all, because oil price in a year is going to depend on how much people invest in new capacity, new production, et cetera. So you can have a high carbon price, relatively high oil price world, or a high carbon price, relatively low oil price world, depending on how individual jurisdictions and actors respond to that future carbon price.
Good. I have a further online question. It's a more technical one. How can we accurately account for GHG emissions related to upstream oil and gas development when the industry in Canada is not even really required to monitor or assess upstream emissions. We know the pipelines, wells, compressor stations, batteries all leak methane, high potency GHG, but we don't know how much, and neither does the industry. We have only estimates. How do we account for this data gap going forward?
Great question. I think important to differentiate their process emissions and fugitives. So to say that the industry is not responsible for reporting on or don't know what their emissions are, that's really a question of leaks and fugitives more so than it is of process emissions. And in particular, when you look at oil sands, your process emissions are going to be a very significant share of your overall emissions. Fugitives are going to be relatively small. Conventional oil and gas fugitives are going to be a larger share potentially of your emissions. So there is no doubt a data gap there. And I'll break that down one step further, which is, it's almost Donald Rumsfeld, the known unknowns and the unknown unknowns. We know that there are pieces of equipment that, pneumatic devices being one example, that bleed methane as a part of their normal course of operations. But then there are also leaks and unintentional fugitive emissions that we have even less data about. So I would separate it into even a more granular challenge. So how do we address that? It's a little bit outside of my scope. We're certainly on that, moving forward on that in Alberta with the new methane program that we proposed. But in terms of the specific mechanics of leak detection, remote sensing, et cetera, you're a little outside of my depth of expertise there.
I do think it was very interesting that the highlight of the methane leak question, especially in the context of fracking, less central to Alberta, but other parts of North America, absolutely central question about how much methane are we actually leaking. And if we take that into account, are we really making as much progress in the transition to gas as we thought we were? Mm-hmm. Further questions here?
Mark, it's Stephen Hazell in Ottawa.
Okay, Stephen, yes.
If I could, I'd make a comment. I appreciate Professor Leach's comments, and it to me, it raises a very interesting idea that perhaps the overall authority of the National Energy Board should in fact be limited to questions of markets and needs, whether or not we have actual or potential markets, whether or not the project is economically feasible, etc. And leave it at that. Have them make recommendations on those matters, but not on other matters that relate to the public interest. And to date, that's been the rub, that the National Energy Board has purported to make decisions and more recently just recommendations to cabinet on the broad public interest, including environmental issues. And of course, that's the area where it's failed miserably. The NEB is great at setting tolls and tariffs, but not so great on the environmental issues. So if we limited the National Energy Board to that specific role and had it make recommendations, then we could have another process that would look at sustainability issues more broadly, and make recommendations to government, and then we might be able to get some good decisions at the end of the day. Because one other comment on this question as to whether or not the current NEB reviews have really been focused on greenhouse gas and climate issues. Nature Canada, where I am now, I mean, we've involved as interveners in both Northern Gateway as well as the Trans Mountain Project, and we're expecting to be an intervener in Energy East. And from our perspective, climate change has really been a small part of the discussion. I mean, much more of the discussion has been about whether or not Indigenous communities have been properly consulted, about cumulative effects, about the risks of oil tanker spills, for example, in the Salish Sea. And those questions have been as important as the climate discussions. And certainly in terms of the lawsuits that have flowed from Northern Gateway and no doubt will flow in terms of Trans Mountain, those lawsuits have been about the risk of tanker spills and the failure of the National Energy Board to do a proper analysis of the risk of tanker spills, as well as cumulative effects, as well as a lack of Indigenous community consultation. So, but I do think that may be a helpful suggestion, because during the panel discussion, we'll be talking about how to reform the National Energy Board process and the environmental assessment process, and this may be a way out to continue to have the board, but have the board focus on sort of the technical stuff that, frankly, the public is probably less interested in.
The question would become then, where does ultimate decision making authority lie to pull all the pieces together? You know, what the NED comes up with, plus what comes through some other process, then somebody's going to have to be the decider, as one of the Bushes said once. A related question, again on the NEB theme, and then I think we might make this the last question for Andrew on this round, and we'll move into our panel. Practical question, does the NEB actually have, this is from Adam Scott, again from Environmental Defense, does the NEB actually have the expertise to do robust GHG analysis and put it in the context of our Paris Agreement obligations? They're equipped to do economic needs assessment, but wouldn't it make far more sense for the Ministry of Energy and Environment and Climate Change to do the GHG assessment as part of a robust environmental assessment and then put the findings in the context of a carbon budget using federal targets, i.e. reducing our emissions by approximately 103 megatons for the next 14 years, the 2030 targets?
So I think kind of jointly responding to both, I think, Mark, you've provided the right overall view, which is at some point somebody has to make a decision, and at some point these processes have to be timely. And the challenge I would give to everybody, you know, if it's a piece of infrastructure you fundamentally don't believe we should build, then having a lengthy environmental process to assess it works in a direction that you see as positive. However, you know, I challenge everybody to think, you know, if your nod is, well, we just need more process or longer process or et cetera, would you want that same logic applied to the local development of a wind plant, a solar plant, some other form of renewable that you might go into thinking immediately, I'm positively predisposed to this? So I think the challenge you have to have an eye to is at some point you can't design the process simply to rule out projects being built. The other important qualifier there is, you know, that Northern Gateway and others, these were not National Energy Board processes. These were joint review panel processes. And so they were explicit combinations of NEB members and Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. So we could have a discussion about whether that's an appropriate mechanism or process to combine those two and have it be with the NEB as the lead agency as opposed to SIA. Then I think a lot of Adam's questions would be flipped, which is, does SIA have the ability to assess markets for a pipeline, viability of that infrastructure over time, likelihood of asset stranding, et cetera? So I think there's advantages of both. The last piece in response to Adam's question, in terms of assessing the greenhouse gas upstream emissions, I think there is going to be a collaboration between the NEB and the Ministries of Environment as there is right now on things like our biennial reports to the United Nations. What I think becomes a challenge is with any individual project, and you know, I'm not trying to put this out there as saying, you know, we can't, every individual project, no matter how you slice it, is going to be a small part. And you're not going to get to a point where Environment Canada is going to be able to say the difference of plus or minus this project is a necessary, leads to a necessary finding that we will not meet our targets. They will most likely come to a conclusion that with or without this project, we're on a path to meet them or we're not on a path to meet them. And the odds that any individual project is going to be marginal to that point is going to be very slim. So then the more challenging question is not who assesses it, but back to Mark's point, how do you put a decision rule around it? And so, you know, the challenge again with pipelines seems like a, you know, this is a big piece of infrastructure, let's make this one where we say, no, it's not consistent with our national target. But boil that down and say, would that same logic make sense in other contexts? So we could run climate models that tell us how many vehicles are likely to be licensed in Canada in a climate-constrained world. Are we going to cut off vehicle licensing? How many houses would be built in different places? Are we going to cap land development? In what other ways are we prepared to exercise this type of sort of looking at the extensive margin, how many of X do we want to have versus the question of compatibility pricing and who has access to their share of the carbon budget. So that would be my kind of quick thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, there's a complicated series of trade-offs there too, both between this balance of timeliness versus the possibility of a no. You know, that has to be present for the process to be credible. And that's been a tension as well. The proponents tend to think if we tick enough boxes, we should be able to get a yes. And if we're going to engage in the conversation about climate impacts and other implications of viability in a relatively timely way, then they have to be prepared to accept that a no could be a possibility too. It's an interesting question of at what stage, you know, do you we tend to focus on large infrastructure for assessment purposes. And we've tended to think, we've acknowledged in some places that land use planning, transportation policy, for example, will affect climate change significantly, but we're still at a baby step stage of incorporating that into things like land use planning policy. So we're starting to get there. The legitimate question is, do you do an assessment at that level, or do you focus more on large, big pieces of infrastructure? And how then do you deal with the cumulative effects of a bunch of smaller but similar things that may add up to quite a bit?
I think you raise an interesting question, Mark, if I can jump back in on that for a quick second, on the probabilities of no. And that's something that you hear a lot about in how do we evaluate these processes. Do they ever say no to anything? And I think there is a piece to that, that yes, it is important that the process be equipped to say no, but we have to be careful that we not extend that back to say the process is not credible if it doesn't ever say no. And that may sound crazy off the top, but you know, turn around to the students and say, how many of you are going to have a failing grade in a third year elective on your transcripts? And that may or may not mean that the third year electives that you're taking are challenging. It's just going to mean that you have a better decision, which is to drop the course. So rather than take a failing grade on a third year elective on your transcript, you're going to exit that course before that failing grade gets there. And I think that's also an important way to judge this process, is that not all projects end up in the assessment process. Not all projects move all the way to a decision point in the assessment process. And that part of the having a credible assessment process is going to be the projects that are in a clearly defined standard. Projects that don't meet it aren't ever going to enter into the assessment process, so they're never going to get to know either. But that in and of itself doesn't mean our process isn't credible.
And one of the problems we're left with out of C38 is we don't actually have a clear set of rules about triggering. They became completely discretionary. And,
right.
And on that note, I think what we might do, Andrew, I don't know, how long can you stay with us?
I can stay for a little while for sure, like okay. 30, 45 minutes or so.
Okay, well, we may at least be able to, well, I think we'll move into our panel phase. And I'm going to introduce our next three speakers. What I'm going to ask people to do is we'll let our speakers go and make their opening comments, and then we'll go back into question and answer phase. And hopefully, Andrew, you'll be able to still be with us at that stage. I think for our panel phase, what we'll do is we'll go east to west. I see David Coon is online. And David, I might call on you first. David Coon is a member of the Legislative Assembly of New Brunswick for Fredericton South, I believe it is, and is also leader of the Green Party in New Brunswick. David has been an environmental educator, organizer, activist, organization manager, most notably was with the Conservation Council of New Brunswick for 28 years. In that capacity, the CCNB won the United Nations Environment Program's Global 500 Award. Mr. Coon himself has received the Silver Medallion from the Canadian Environmental Achievement Awards for his work to advance public policy on climate change, both provincially and nationally. And I invited David to join us specifically for the purpose of bringing, we've heard a lot from Quebec, we've heard a lot from BC, we've heard a lot from Ontario about these conversations. We hadn't heard that much from Atlantic Canada and the endpoint, particularly of Energy East. And so it was in that context that David seemed to be the logical person to bring into this discussion and to bring that perspective into the conversation. So if we're queued up, Michael, are we good? David, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. We're good. We've got you on screen as well.
Thanks, Mark, and good afternoon, everyone. I guess where I'd start here, perhaps, is where I should start, and that is with First Nations, before we get into any discussion about process. In New Brunswick, there's two things regarding First Nations that are important to know. One is that, like British Columbia, land was never ceded here or acquired by conquest from any of the three nations, the Passamaquoddy, the Wolastoqiyik, or the Mi'kmaq. Unlike British Columbia, there are actually treaties, peace and friendship treaties, which lay out some useful information about who does what. But so that's an important backdrop for this discussion. Land wasn't ceded, and the treaties that exist essentially are peace treaties that were signed as a result of the British military's inability to deal with the kind of the military capacity of the First Nations of the day, particularly, believe it or not, in the coastal waters up and down the seaboard here. So that creates a very different dynamic than in Quebec and Ontario. The pipeline route runs through pretty much entirely the territory of the Wolastoqiyik, or Maliseet as they used to be called. That's a Mi'kmaq name, and they're choosing to use their own name these days, Mi'kmaq name for them. Anyway, so it runs through mostly their territory, through this down the St. John River Valley and through the St. John River watershed into St. John, ultimately where the export terminal would be built. So that whole discussion is at very early stages. Certainly the Grand Council, so the traditional council, has clearly come out in opposition to allowing the pipeline to transit its territory, and at least two INAC chiefs have supported that position from that First Nation, and there's multiple communities along the route, First Nation communities, as part of the Wolastoqiyik Nation. So there's that. The second item, I guess, is that the company never registered its project pipeline, that is TransCanada, never registered it, as this would be required under the Clean Environment Act, specifically under the Environmental Impact Assessment Regulation. So it's unclear what was going on there. I have a request into the Ombudsman for some time now to investigate whether or not the minister failed to carry out his mandate by not requiring the company to register the project for provincial environmental assessment. The Department of Environment and Local Government has registered in the NEDB process to be an intervener, but it's unclear, other than being champions of the pipeline, as is the premier and this current government, whether or not they would do more than cheerleading without having their staff directly engaged in reviewing an environmental impact assessment carried out under the provincial regulation. So the Ombudsman has yet to report with on their investigation into this yet, so that's still out there and waiting. As I said, with First Nations, the consultation stage has, I would say, is very early levels. It's not been very robust. with them. Strangely enough, there's probably been more consultation, or at least discussion, I won't call it consultation, with at least one of the Mi'kmaq communities, which is at considerable distance, almost on the east coast of New Brunswick, considerable distance from the pipeline route. So that's an oddity, which I don't quite understand at this point. But anyways, that's what has happened. The other dynamic, I would say, is two other things, and it has to do with water in both cases and local communities. So the city of Edmundston in the northwest corner of New Brunswick and Madawaska County or region, the pipeline traverses its drinking water supply. And it is taking the position that the pipeline at minimum needs to be rerouted around it, which is a considerable distance on the order of, I think, 50, 60, 70 kilometers, something like that. So the city of Edmundston is very much in play on this issue because of the route going over its drinking water supply, and which would be groundwater. And then the other water-related issue at the community level is this does, because it goes through the St. John River watershed, go close to a lot of highly valued watersheds by local communities, particularly in the southern New Brunswick, and those communities are sort of beginning to understand that, and so we will see, I expect, some kind of engagement from them in the future. Then, of course, the final dynamic, which was touched on earlier around this, and it is the case here as well, and that is the issue of building new significant infrastructure that would lock us into increased production and significant marketing of significant quantities of high carbon fuels for another generation. So those are sort of the issues that are playing here. That, of course, the backdrop economically is New Brunswick has, its economy hasn't moved in years. And there is, you know, a high level of interest in anything that's going to create short-term work for a couple of years to employ people. So we're not unfamiliar with pipelines in that there are two natural gas pipelines traversing New Brunswick, and everyone realizes that the work associated with those was really essentially connected to their construction. But at the time, people did get work from it, and there's lots of people looking for the opportunity to get some short-term work out of this project. So that's also a real dynamic at play here. On the federal side, I don't have the time to intervene myself, but I did request to submit a letter, and will be doing so. As for the perspective of my own party on this, we come at it very much from the perspective of both First Nations concerns and a climate change concern. And that is the problem with building brand new infrastructure that's got a long lifetime that will significantly increase the production and ultimately consumption over time of fossil fuels. So hopefully that gives you a sense of where we're coming from and what's going on here. Much of the content of the pipeline on Energy East would be exported as dilbit, but of course the Irving Oil Refinery in St. John will be able to contract for light crude on the line from time to time when it's cheaper than other alternatives. And of course they have many alternatives, including now like crude from the Enbridge number 9 line out of Montreal to it's the refinery in St. John. They own ships. They acquired a very large oil storage facility in the port of Montreal, and that's been added to their sort of menu of options for acquiring light crude for the refinery.
Good. Thank you, David. I'm going to go through our panelists first, and then we'll do question and answer after all three have spoken. So I was going to call on Stephen Hazell next. Stephen is Director of Conservation and General Counsel with Nature Canada. He has served as a Executive Director of Nature Canada and Executive Director of Sierra Club and Canadian Parks and Wilderness Society. He has also worked in government as Director of Legislative and Regulatory Affairs with the Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency, and was involved in the development of the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. Indeed, many remember he was involved in the original litigation around the Rafferty Alameda Dam. Stephen has written numerous scholarly articles on environmental assessment in Canada, as well as the book Canada Versus the Environment, which was a study on environmental assessment law and policy at the federal level. Stephen.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks for the invitation to participate. I wanted to focus on, you know, what's happening with respect to the reform of the federal environmental assessment process and of the National Energy Board. The National Energy Board is a dirty word, but so is environmental assessment. They are both very much in disfavor. With the National Energy Board, I mean, we have statements such as from the Liberal Party platform indicating a loss of public trust in the National Energy Board. And they've resolved to fix that by way of modernizing the National Energy Board, whatever modernizing means. And Minister Carr, the Natural Resources Minister, has indicated that he will be moving forward with a process leading to some sort of reform of the National Energy Board. Environmental assessment, in my view, has been in decline for many, many years. At the federal level, of course, you know, we have projects not being built and the environmental assessment process being blamed for that, sometimes correctly, sometimes not. Certainly in Ontario, we have, I mean, the Ontario Environmental Assessment Act has for decades been known as the Environmental Exemptions Act, but it's taken it even to greater heights in recent years. You know, the fact that the Environmental Assessment Act doesn't apply to wind and solar energy projects, for example, is just one example. So much so that the Honorable Glenn Murray, the Minister of Environment and Climate Change in Ontario, who in other respects, I certainly see as a champion for the environment, said at a public conference that he didn't know that much about environmental assessment, but what he did know, he didn't like. So that was the minister being quite candid. So we're at a point now, at least federally, where we need to make some reforms to both the National Energy Board and to the federal environmental assessment process. I want to talk a little bit about the process for reforming environmental assessment first. The Liberal government is committed to conducting an immediate public review of environmental assessment processes. And we expect that they will tell us what their process for doing that is going to be within the next month or two. The environmental community has kind of got together in a number of ways in order to influence that decision. We've got the Environmental Assessment Caucus of the Canadian Environmental Network, of which Anna Johnston is a co-chair. And there was another initiative which I took with a colleague from the Mining Association of Canada to revive what was called the Regulatory Advisory Committee, which is a multi-stakeholder group of environmentalists, industry folks, representatives of Indigenous organizations and academics. And I should say also, sorry, that John Sinclair, who I think is on this call, was also involved in planning this whole effort. So the idea is that whatever is done with respect to reconsidering you know, the very bad things that the Conservatives did to the Federal Environmental Assessment Act, that there should be public consultation about it going forward. And further, that we really need to involve Indigenous communities more than has ever been the case before. And I think Anna may have something to say about that too. So we have this process going forward. There were also some urgent needs that the Liberal government had to look to with respect to the pipeline hearings. And I just wanted to be totally clear about what's gone on with respect to the pipeline hearings. It is true, as Andrew said, that the Northern Gateway was a joint process between the National Energy Board and the Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency, but it was very much NEB dominated in that the chair and one of the other three members of the panel are NEB members, and the secretariat is also predominantly run by the National Energy Board. With respect to Trans Mountain or Kinder Morgan, that is a National Energy Board process, and Energy East is a National Energy Board process. So what the government did a few weeks ago was they released some what they call interim measures to sort of put a quick fix on to the ongoing assessment of Trans Mountain and for the proposed Energy East pipeline process. And those were important steps that the government took, I think. And one of them, I think, we've been debating it quite a bit already this afternoon, the question of looking at upstream GHG emissions. So that was included as part of the considerations relating to Trans Mountain. And they've made some similar moves with respect to Energy East. I would argue most of them positive. The problem remains they didn't deal with one that was very important to Nature Canada, and that was the question of being able to ask the proponent questions during hearings. For the first time in my working life, the National Energy Board denied interveners the right to ask questions of proponents in hearings. And we think that's wrong. We think there's almost no point in having a hearing if you're going to deny people the right to ask oral questions in hearings. That's where you get to test the veracity of their evidence and similarly allow the proponents to question your own expert witnesses. So we have this interim process for the pipelines, but we really do need a new Environmental Assessment Act that covers that does things quite a bit differently than is currently done. Right now, the environmental assessment process really looks at significant adverse environmental effects and how you can mitigate them. We think that the process really should try to identify the best project, try to assist proponents in making their projects better. We think that instead of just looking narrowly at environmental effects, we should be looking more broadly at sustainability. Because many of the issues that have arisen in the various pipeline hearings especially haven't been so much about biophysical effects. They've been about other stuff, like have you consulted with Indigenous communities properly? Are you looking at cumulative effects, etc.? What about the social and cultural issues? Those are all important too. They can all be accounted for within a sustainability framework, but under the current framework where you're very narrowly focused on biophysical effects, it's not so easily done. So there are a number of substantive reforms that we would like to see to the legislation, but we do want to see how this federal process rolls out. And the government, they may turn to the House of Commons Standing Committee to conduct this review, and presumably there'll be opportunities for the public to get involved. We think a better course would be to have an independent panel to work on it and to report back and to have public input into their decisions. We recognize that this has got to be done fairly quickly because we want new legislation into the House within the next, no more than 2 years, so that the government can get the legislation passed within this current mandate. So perhaps I'll stop there and turn it over to Adam.
Thanks, Stephen. I think that's going to be a very interesting question, too, about not only the content of new legislation, but also the timing, because I sometimes worry the window is closing already in terms of what might find its way into new legislation. The fact that some of the more obvious problems of C-38 in terms of participation, you know, the 10-page form to file a letter, the inability to cross-examine, the evidence of the proponent, which could have been fixed off the bat, weren't. And that was somewhat concerning. But with that, I'm going to turn it over to Anna. Anna Johnston is our third speaker. She is a counsel with West Coast Environmental Law. And she is also the co-chair of the newly revitalized Canadian Environmental Network Caucus on Environmental Planning and Assessment, and particularly the EA Reform Working Group. Anna's work at West Coast is focused on developing and advancing law reform proposals and practical solutions related to environmental assessment law and federal environmental law rollbacks, and hopefully now moving beyond rollbacks and more into positive change. So, Anna, are you with us there?
I am.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm really pleased to be here to be speaking with this eminently respectable panel. I think that, so I took the title of the talk, and especially the word political, I'm giving it long reign. So I'm going to shift over from the talks that have been going on a little bit into the, I'm going to give a little bit of the backstory of the changes in C-38 to Canadian environmental laws, and then the shift that's been occurring over the last 6 months or so, and that has led us to this point now where we look like we're on the cusp of hopefully being able to build something a little bit better or even a lot better. So I have a presentation, and please forgive me if some of this is old news for you. But I thought it would be interesting to look at that, the political tensions and the tug of war that have been going on in environmental assessment in Canada over the last, say, half dozen years. So is that okay? Is it up?
Yes, it's working. We can see it here.
Great. So I'm going to begin with a history, a little bit of the backstory to C-38. So in December 2011, a group called the Energy Framework Initiative wrote a letter to the Ministers of Environment and the Ministers of Natural Resources. The EFI is, as you can see, a group of four of Canada's sort of leading associations on pipelines and energy. There had been a lot of lobbying going on other federal environmental laws as well. This letter was pretty broad-reaching. It asked for widespread regulatory changes to Canada's environmental laws, including things like the Species at Risk Act. For the sake of this talk, I'm just going to focus on their key asks related to environmental assessment. And so the letter really asked for a lot of the things that, as I'm going to get to, was granted in the new CIA 2012. So they wanted a reduction in process duplication and overlap with other governments. They wanted to focus regulatory attention on key issues, right? So let's sort of narrow what gets considered in environmental assessments. Let's keep appropriate timelines. They emphasized that the Canadian energy industry has a significant role to play in shaping Canada's future. So they're really discussing with the government a lot of legislative changes here. And Stephen mentioned earlier this multi-stakeholder group, the Regulatory Advisory Committee, that had been a group that had been advising the Minister of Environment and the Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency on environmental assessment related issues for quite some time. It's my understanding that some of the groups in the Energy Framework Initiative were a part of that Regulatory Advisory Committee, but they really stepped behind that committee there, sort of behind its back, and started to talk directly with government about sweeping legislative changes that could essentially get shovels in the ground quickly. They wanted to get these projects going. And the context for this letter is, this is right in the middle of the Enbridge Northern Gateway hearings, where there was a ton of opposition from the public and from Indigenous groups. So, you know, there's a strong inference that one can draw here that this letter was essentially a way to reduce that kind of opposition that was keeping projects like Northern Gateway delayed, in their words, through these regulatory processes. We saw a very sort of large, warm, welcoming hug from the Minister of Natural Resources to that letter, essentially reiterating a lot of the things that were brought up in that letter, and then kind of tearing a strip out of environmental groups, calling us foreign-funded radicals, threatening to hijack the regulatory system, and saying that, yes, you're right, these projects are getting delayed and caught up in these regulatory processes, and so we need a quicker and more streamlined set of regulations in order to get these projects approved quickly. And you can see there that that's about a month after the Energy Framework Initiative letter. This was a public letter. It's still, or at least up until the election, it was on the government's website. So then, of course, later that year, we saw Bill C-38 and C-45, which made sweeping changes to a number of Canada's oldest and most important federal environmental laws, including the Fisheries Act, the Species at Risk Act, the Navigable Waters Protection Act, it acts the Kyoto Protocol Implementation Act, and then of course replaced CIA with CIA 2012. And I just want to take a minute to look at some of the major changes, which you're probably all familiar with, in CIA 2012, and relate them back to that Energy Framework Initiative letter. So, you know, let's avoid duplication, right? So that bottom bullet there was in CIA 2012. Now, the federal government can substitute a provincial environmental assessment for a federal one if a provincial government asks and the minister believes that the provincial assessment, you know, will be equivalent to a federal one, then the minister actually has to approve the substitution. That substitution clause has been used quite a bit here in British Columbia. I think that we are the lone province that's really using that clause. But here in BC, what it's meant is that for a lot of our projects, from mines to some of the LNG facilities that are proposed here in BC, the feds have essentially stepped back and said, we're not going to conduct an environmental assessment. We're just going to rely on the provincial one, which is troubling because there have been instances here in BC where there's been a provincial EA and a federal EA parallel to each other. For example, I think the main one that comes to mind is the Prosperity Mine, where the mining company proposed to turn a fish lake into a tailings pond. The province did an EA, the feds did an EA, the province concluded that there would be no significant adverse effects, and the feds concluded that, in fact, turning fish lake into a tailings pond would result in significant adverse effects, and also there would be significant adverse effects on grizzlies and Indigenous people. So here in BC, we're seeing the substitution of federal EAs for provincial ones, and this assumption that the provincial process is going to be adequate, even though we've seen on the ground that they're not comparable. The imposition of mandatory timelines, again, I think that was brought up earlier on in this discussion. That has been very constricting in environmental assessments. And again, it was asked for in that Energy Framework Initiative letter. It has made environmental reviews, especially of complicated or contentious projects, quite difficult. I was representing a community group on the environmental assessment of the Site C Dam, and we had, by the time the joint review panel determined that it had enough information from the proponent to call the hearings, because of the timelines, it could only give us 30 days. It could only give the public 30 days to review that information, prepare our submissions, submit them, and then hold the hearings, which meant we actually, to be fair to BC Hydro, the proponent, we had to get our information in 2 weeks ahead of the hearing to allow BC Hydro to reply. So we had 2 weeks to review the over 10,000 pages of information. And and then get our experts to prepare reports and to submit them. The joint review panel itself seemed to be working around the clock. It was far too constricting and resulted in a completely inadequate assessment of the information, both by the public and also by the review panel. The reduction of what should be considered an environmental assessment, we saw that that the Energy Framework Initiative had asked for, we got in both the narrowing of environmental effects that get, or the narrowing of effects that get considered, and then also the movement towards this, the listing approach rather than the triggering approach. So it used to be the case under SEIA that any project that involved the federal government in some way, so if the feds funded it, if the feds approved it, if it occurred on federal land, it got some level of assessment generally, or usually, and now projects only get assessed if they're listed in regulations. So I'm probably telling most of you stuff that you already know, but what I want to emphasize here is that the changes that industry asked for were handed to them. And within, I don't know, 8 months of them asking for it. So we saw the power really being held by industry at that time. But then we saw a shift. There was the sun started to burst through the clouds, and environmental assessment began to get sexy. In the lead up to the election, I think things had started to get clear that tearing away at environmental regulations wasn't getting shovels in the ground any faster. In British Columbia alone, in 1 year, there were 38 lawsuits against major resource development proposals. The protests against Enbridge and especially against Kinder Morgan were making headlines across the country. There were then injunction applications and court cases against Kinder Morgan. So it really catalyzed Kinder Morgan, especially the Trans Mountain proposal, really catalyzed British Columbians into action in a way that we hadn't seen since probably the 1990s against logging in Clayquot Sound. And groups were on the ground. There were groups like Lead Now and the Dogwood Initiative that were doing door-to-door organizing, getting people to sign vote pledges saying that they were going to vote for parties or candidates that were most likely to enact stronger environmental regulations and say no to these kinds of projects. As a result of that, and I'm sure many other efforts, environmental law reform entered the platforms of three out of the four main national parties. So the Greens, the Liberals, and the NDP all promised to review environmental assessments, strengthen the processes, and make better credible processes that the public could trust and that would do a better job of protecting the environment. I'm going to focus more on the Liberal commitments because they have become our government. They committed to fully implementing the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, which is really groundbreaking. It's Canada signed that treaty, but it has not been implemented here. And what the key element of UNDRIP is, of course, free, prior, and informed consent that it effectively gives Indigenous governments a veto power over projects in their territories. That those election promises were largely carried through post-election in November 2015. As Stephen mentioned before, the Minister of Environment and Climate Change, as well as with support from the Fisheries, Transport, and Natural Resources Ministers, were given the mandate to immediately review Canada's environmental assessment processes to regain public trust and get resources to market and introduce new fair processes that will do a bunch of very good things. Essentially what they're looking for are processes that environmental assessment processes that Canadians can trust. They're looking for something that will give social license to projects because it's become clear that voters, the electorate, and also the people who are willing to take to the street, whether or not they vote, do hold quite a bit of power in pipeline project approvals. So how are things going post-election? It's still not looking good for pipelines. Here in BC, we had a recent decision by the BC Supreme Court, the Coastal First Nations versus British Columbia, that determined that the province cannot give its decision-making responsibility to the federal government. So that was... as that case was a challenge to the equivalency agreement that BC and Canada entered into, saying that BC would rely for the major oil pipelines proposed through British Columbia, BC would not conduct its own environmental assessment, that it would rely on the NEB assessment, but also it went one step further and said that it was just going to rely on the federal decision. And the court here made two important findings. One was that BC had to make its own decision, so it has to issue an environmental assessment certificate. It can rely on the results and the recommendations of the NEB, but it has to make that decision itself. And it also can put conditions on the pipelines, so long as those conditions aren't effectively a bar to the pipeline. BC doesn't have the jurisdiction to say no, but it does have the jurisdiction, ironically, to say yes with qualifications. A second important finding in that case was that because of this equivalent, there's in the equivalency agreement, there's a clause that says BC can withdraw up until a certain period of time before the decision. And because it has this ability to withdraw, it needs to consult with affected Indigenous groups on specific environmental assessments about whether or not it ought to withdraw from the equivalency agreement. And it hadn't done that consultation with the First Nations in question, and so now BC has been told it has to go back and do that consultation process. I don't work directly on either the Northern Gateway or the Kinder Morgan files. Stephen spoke about Kinder Morgan a little bit. I do know that things are looking very bad for Northern Gateway at this time. It's fighting 18 legal challenges in court, and it also hasn't, as of December 2015 at least, firmed up any of its supply contracts, and it needs 60% of them done in, I can't remember by what date, but it's looming. One of the First Nations groups that we work closely with said not too long ago that we're running out of nails to hammer that coffin lid down with. As for Kinder Morgan, British Columbia, in its submissions on the NEB process, essentially rejected, it doesn't, of course, again, have jurisdiction to do so, but it did tell the NEB that Kinder Morgan had not met the five conditions that British Columbia said a major oil pipeline would have to meet in order for British Columbia to give it its blessing. Consent for the project was also withheld by the Tsleil-Waututh First Nation, which is the First Nation that... whose territory not only will the pipeline cross, but also those tankers will be crossing its waters. So they conducted their own environmental assessment based on their own Indigenous laws and also robust external science, and concluded that it could not approve the project. And then, of course, because of that recent Coastal First Nations decision, BC is going to have to go back to the First Nations and do a lot of consultation with them, and then decide whether or not to issue its provincial certificate and what conditions to apply. So we're, again, I just would like to reiterate that the weakening of environmental laws requested by industry do not appear to be working out for industry well at all. So on to what we can do. What kind of process will work? What kind of process will work for industry, and what kind of process will work for governments and the public and Indigenous governments as well? as Stephen mentioned, the process of reviewing that law is really important, and environmental groups have been speaking with various government officials about what that process should look like. We are calling for a review by an independent body. We don't think that a review done by the NEB or the Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency, there could be doubt in the public's mind as to the credibility of reviews undertaken by the bodies that are being reviewed. also if by the government, we don't want at this stage political considerations to be taken into account. So there needs to be a review by some sort of independent body. So let's say a panel, or it's been suggested a commission. I think a panel would work with Indigenous representation on that panel to do that kind of deep thinking into what a better process or better processes should look like. And to, you know, especially engage the public and Indigenous groups. That process needs to be designed with Indigenous governments and groups, because Indigenous governments and groups are going to be necessarily involved in the decision-making processes if the Libs want to, or if the government wants to uphold its commitment to under the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. So that panel will probably need some kind of an expert body, you know, a task force that has that deep expertise on environmental assessment, that can write discussion papers, probe into outstanding questions, ask the bigger picture questions. We need to be asking, what's the purpose of environmental assessment? What are its goals? What are its main principles? There needs to be direct government-to-government discussions with Indigenous governments as well, so not just from the panel, of course, but also coming from the federal government. And then the outcomes of that independent review can then be given to Cabinet with recommendations on what a better law could look like. You know, then the customary steps to developing a law can begin. The minister makes a proposal to Cabinet, and then Cabinet gives drafting orders to legislative drafters, and a bill goes to a parliamentary committee. And believe it or not, all of this we do think can happen within the next 18 to 20 months. The pundits say that in order to get visionary transformative law introduced in Parliament, generally that needs to occur, for political reasons that are largely over my head, that needs to occur within the first half of a government's term. So we're looking at a, you know, sort of by the end of 2017 if we want to get a sort of visionary change in environmental legislation. And of course, substantively, what do we think a visionary new law would look like? There are very, very wise people out there, some of whom are on this video conference, who have been thinking quite a bit about what we can do to move towards environmental assessment, or what the next generation environmental assessment can look like, in a way that will work for industry and for the public and for the environment. Sustainability as the core objective is a key element. So looking not just to whether a project will have adverse environmental impacts and how to mitigate or avoid those impacts, but whether or not projects or proposals or plans will make a positive contribution to the well-being of communities and to the environment. Also, we really need to start using strategic environmental assessments, so assessments of plans, policies, and proposals, and then linking those assessments to projects and vice versa. So if, for example, here in British Columbia, we had, when the first proposal for an LNG terminal hit the table, if the province had stepped back and said, whoa, okay, we see a huge interest in this coming down the pike, we should do a strategic environmental assessment, then we wouldn't be having this problem of there being, you know, 20 odd proposals for LNG facilities all over the coast of British Columbia, from, you know, a handful down here on in Vancouver Island, and then all the way up to northern BC, and with probably only the provincial capacity for one or two of them. A strategic assessment would have ask those bigger picture questions like, do we want LNG at all? If we do, are there places that can environmentally and socially handle those kinds of projects? And are there communities that really want them? Rather than leaving it up to individual project proponents to try to make their pitch to communities, and then leaving it up to communities and Indigenous groups to take it to the courts and take it to the streets to oppose them. We, of course, need better consideration of cumulative effects, the meaningful involvement of Indigenous governments as decision makers, and way better public participation, because as soon as you block the public from being able to participate, as soon as you give them those 10-page applications, they're going to get frustrated and they're again going to take to the streets and to the courts. So I've glossed over a lot of stuff here. I think I'll wrap up and maybe you should open it up to questions.
Thanks, Anna. That in itself begged another question from my part, but I'm going to hold and see how we are both in the room and online. So any questions on the presentations so far? Yes.
Leah here again. I want to just say that that was absolutely superb. Now, my question is, how do we get involved? How do people get involved in supporting your initiative? Thank you.
So in the public review, are you asking how do you get involved in advising what the public review of environmental assessment should look like?
I want to get involved in what you just described. How can we get behind, is it your group that's proposing or some umbrella group, or like who's doing it, and how do we get involved with it?
There are, and Stephen, do you want to go?
Yeah, well, I two things spring to mind, Lee. First of all, you could join the Environmental Planning and Assessment Caucus, and that's one way you could get involved. I mean, typically we have groups that appoint representatives to the caucus, but if you want to chat, I'm sure we can figure out a way to get you involved. That's the first thing. The second thing is that we are waiting on the government, and we're expecting a cabinet decision. You know, it's fairly soon. It's hard to say because there's a long lineup of ministers in front of the trying to get into cabinet right now. But we are expecting something soon. And once we know what the process is going to be for reviewing the federal environmental assessment laws, there will be lots of opportunities for the public to get involved. So those would be two ideas. But frankly, we're kind of in a holding pattern right now ourselves, just waiting for a cabinet decision.
Yeah, and I should add that we've been told that decision on the announcement of the environmental assessment review will occur sometime early this summer, June or July. I think Stephen's suggestion that you join the caucus is probably a good one, and there are individual memberships available for the caucus. Also, I administer a website, envirolawsmatter.ca, that we'll be using to put out information on the review and opportunities for people to make comments.
I would add, in these circumstances, noise in general, in the form of letters to ministers and other things, reminding them to keep it moving forward is always helpful. Yes, just to follow up.
Just a question of your process, I guess. Has this information you just presented been made available to the cabinet people who are making the decision? Could you sort of give me a bit of background on that?
Yes, very much so. I mean, a number of us were on this call, including John Sinclair, myself, Anna, and others. We've had many conversations with Minister McKenna's office in particular, but also with the Prime Minister's office. I mean, there's a very interesting group of people in the Environment Minister's office, including Marlo Reynolds, from who's to be the Executive Director of the Pembina Institute, but lots of very interesting people, and also to be fair, in the Natural Resources Minister's office as well. So we've had a number of conversations with them, and it's I'll just speak for myself. I'm just delighted at how this government has been so responsive to listening to folks who felt like we've been wandering in the wilderness, yay, these 10 years.
Good. Further questions over here.
Thanks, David and Stephen and Anna. This is Lara Tesaro here in Toronto. And I have a question. I think it's probably mostly for Stephen and Anna about kind of the legal implications of the interim review process. and particularly for Kinder Morgan. And just kind of to explain where I'm coming from, it is as often kind of thinking about this through the lens of administrative law, where as people know, you know, the failure to consider a relevant consideration is unlawful. And here we have kind of a contest, I think, over the last 15 years about whether consideration of upstream effects, GHG, air pollution is relevant, right? We've seen this not just in the context of pipelines, but from CMS Energy 2, from GSX, you know, all these joint review panels where there's been a contest about the relevance of considering upstream effects, with some review panels and NEB panels willing to take that step and others not. And particularly with Enbridge and Kinder Morgan, we've seen a refusal to accept the notion that upstream effects are relevant. And here we have suddenly a political announcement where there seems to be a concession that this is, in fact, a relevant consideration, and yet at the same time, a decision that relevant consideration will be considered through an extra statutory process and not through the statutory process by the statutory decision maker or recommender, at least, or with the involvement of the public or interveners. Those bodies are being deprived of the opportunity to comment and contribute to something that is now being deemed relevant. And I'm just wondering if your organizations have kind of, particularly for Kinder Morgan, given the stage of where it's at and the timing of the interim process announcement, have considered whether, you know, this raises questions about the legality of excluding relevant considerations from statutory processes. If that makes sense.
Stephen looks ready to go on this.
No, Laura, that totally makes sense, and thanks for the question. I haven't done a legal opinion on whether or not the approach that the government has taken in not referring the matters of upstream greenhouse gases back into the NEB process is unlawful or not. I mean, I think it's an interesting one. One that we have looked at is the question of whether or not the decision of the board to deny us the right to cross-examine witnesses is unlawful, and we think there's a case there. So I'm not saying that there will necessarily be an application for judicial review post the Kinder Morgan hearings, but I think there's a case there for somebody. So I haven't looked at it, but I think it's a really interesting legal issue. And the government may have put themselves in a bit of a box by taking the approach that they've taken.
I've wondered the same question. Anna, do you have any thoughts on this?
Yeah, well, we haven't, as far as I know, we haven't looked into it either. I don't work directly on either of the pipelines. I'm more of an EA in a vacuum kind of person. I do know that they came to these conditions without consulting us at all, which is one of the few things that they have done without talking to us. I do think it raises some really important questions, but it also, I think I'd come back to that, the fact that when governments are given such huge discretion to make decisions, when decisions are put into the hands of cabinet, then, you know, certainly here in the BC context, we've seen the courts say that we have a similar decision-making process here in BC, and that governments get to take into consideration anything, including political considerations. So there's a lot less accountability in decision-making in general when we have these kinds of behind-the-scenes cabinet decisions. I don't think that answers your question. It just maybe raises another one.
The assumption is the court would give the cabinet a great deal of discretion in terms of what it ultimately decides to do.
Yeah.
Further questions? I've got one for Anna, actually, just to follow up, and I think it's relevant to Ontario, Quebec, and New Brunswick. What happens post the BC, the First Nations decision? What happens if BC declines to issue a certificate under the BC environmental assessment process for a project? What happens then?
Okay, well, that is,
if its conditions are not met and BC says no, or New Brunswick says no, or Quebec says no, Where do we stand?
Probably the feds would challenge the decision on the grounds that BC doesn't have the jurisdiction to say no to a pipeline of, you know, within federal jurisdiction, and probably the feds would win. It's unfortunate. I mean, at least that's what the BC Supreme Court was saying. That's what we've seen in other decisions related to these kind of, you know, paramountcy issues, the jurisdictional questions, that while the province has shared jurisdiction over the pipelines and therefore can regulate in some ways, the province's power is limited to a matter of regulation rather than a matter of veto. So what that probably means, I mean, we would love to see our province say no and take it to the courts and make clever arguments. We finally get a precedent saying that provinces can have the ability to say no over these kinds of issues. We'd like to see more community-based decision-making, more localized decision-making. Almost certainly not going to happen here in BC. It's a political hot potato. We have an election coming up in May 2017. So we've got a province that's going to be tiptoeing around the issue. Back to your question, though, if BC imposed conditions that rendered the project effectively impossible, those conditions would probably also be found to be outside of BC's powers.
I agree with Anna's last conclusion that BC provincial governments have got no authority to stop an interprovincial pipeline, such as those that the NEB regulates. Those type of projects, interprovincial pipelines, are matters of exclusive legislative responsibility of the government of Canada, of the federal government, and that's hard to swallow for a lot of folks, not just in Quebec. But that's basically what the Supreme Court has said, and there seems to be some ability at the margins of provinces, like as Anna says, the possibility you can say yes potentially with certain conditions, but it certainly there's no, I mean, in my reading of the law, I had an Articling student look at it just last week, that the provincial governments cannot say no to Kinder Morgan or to Energy East, and I know it's maybe an artifact, but I think that's the law right now.
But it seems to me that the Willistook-Way could say no to Energy East.
Yeah, well, it could be. I think that's right. I mean, Indigenous communities might have more authority to say no than the provinces do. That's an interesting thought.
So in effect, well, there are different ways it could play out. I mean, the NEB could make a provincial conditionality part of its conditions on an approval. Might be one way that happens.
Can I jump in on this for a second as well?
Sure, Andrew, yeah, please.
So, you know, I think the framing of the discussion here is really important. It's this question of do we allow subnationals or regions or what have you to have implicit veto over projects. And I think, you know, not to go too far against what Anna said, I think everybody's right on where the jurisdiction lies. But it was interesting to see sort of the follow-up of, well, and I hope they are able to say no. And I think we have to be careful about asking the questions, why do we have these jurisdictional overrides, and not to wish them away so that we can have a particular outcome on a particular project that we want, but rather go back and ask the question, or we don't want, is this the right way to frame regulation? And so I brought it up in my talk of, you know, let's not make this about getting the regulatory environment we want to get the outcome we want in this particular case. Let's make sure we have the regulatory system which allows appropriate stakeholders to have a voice while not allowing a disproportionate veto over projects which would be in the national interest. And I'm not speaking to say that any one of these pipelines necessarily is or is not, but I think the challenge for everybody is not to judge the appropriate regulatory framework by the one that leads to the result that I deem to be appropriate in a particular context.
it could be a two-way street depending on the context.
Well, I think, you know, we've certainly seen, and you know, we see it, we've seen it across Canada, particularly at the municipal level, where, you know, you look at Vancouver, where you've got an extremely progressive mayor and council that are going to put up significant opposition to pipeline projects, but you've seen the reverse with the deployment of renewable energy in Ontario, for example, or other areas where the ability for a provincial government or a provincial regulatory authority, see it here in some sense with transmission reinforcement that you need, the ability for super jurisdictional imposition on this, on these files, can actually be of benefit. And so don't confound the negative aspects of a particular project with the negative aspects of having a jurisdiction that can supersede sort of locals where required.
Although that can get politically very messy, as we discovered with wind turbines in Ontario. It didn't work out so well. But I'm going to go on to, I've got a couple of online questions, and I'll go on to them, and maybe we'll aim to wrap around 3:30 local time. Just a comment, this is from someone, David Suzuki Foundation. Just want to comment, it seems to me that the environmental assessment process is completely backwards. Before companies even engage with government and SIA, they should first be required to engage with the affected First Nations and public, open the books on their plans and see if there's either appetite for what is being proposed or if there can be acceptable alternative options that all can live with. Only after doing that should they be permitted to go to government and seek EA approval. Right now, millions of dollars are spent at the front end by companies. Government regulatory agencies encourage the development of the project, and only after that is the public engaged. Government's hands are pretty much tied in terms of project approval, absent huge public outcry. Comments, thoughts on that one?
It's interesting that lines up well with the findings and recommendations of the recently released report from the Commission on Fracking in New Brunswick that basically said some of the same things, only looking forward. That is, they've got to build trust in public institutions by meaningfully engaging with communities and build an actual relationship with First Nations in the province. We've had this whole discussion in New Brunswick around social license initiated by the provincial government when it came in and instituted the moratorium on fracking and said one of their criteria for lifting was that social license had been achieved. And it sort of sounds like that's what the questioner is suggesting.
Other comments? I'm going to just go back to my online and I'll come back here. Another question on this from John Sinclair, University of Manitoba. Question about CNSC and the National Energy Board. We're talking about reform of the assessment process, but these are regulatory bodies. Stephen suggests one role the NEB might play. Other thoughts on these regulatory agencies and assessment? I think he's asking the question partially about the role of the NEB, CNSC, and others outside of the environmental assessment process as regulators.
I think we could go any number of ways with these regulatory bodies. I mean, the problem with some of them right now is that the regulatory decisions are kind of downstream decisions. Whereas environmental assessment, you want to do up front as part of a planning process. And I'm hearkening back to David's comments just a second ago. It's a challenge. But on the other hand, you don't want to have two sets of hearings. Like in the Mackenzie Gas Project hearings, we had an environmental assessment process and we had an NEB process. And that was not the way to go. So, you know, I'm not sure what to do. And I mean, I'm stimulated by Andrew's comments that maybe we should be thinking about really having a tight focus for some of these regulatory bodies and then having a broader sustainability assessment process in front of that that can look at sort of, bigger public policy issues and you know, the whole range of issues that one would typically undertake in an environmental assessment. But I'm not sure. I don't know quite how to deal with that. I mean, the NEB is unacceptable is the way it's written. The CNSC, I'm not sure is any better. What to do about it? I don't know. Hopefully, we'll get some brilliant thoughts from this independent panel.
Folks, I have to sign off here. So thanks very much for inviting me to do this, and thanks to Sophie especially for the invite.
Thanks, Andrew. That was great. I think we're pretty close to a wrap here as well. I think we have a question or two. A little round of thanks for Andrew for his participation. And I see two more questions in the room, and then I think we'll wrap. Thank you, Andrew. Yes, back here. Thank you.
Oh, yeah. I was just going to comment on the questioner who suggested that the proponents would be wise to build a social license with Indigenous communities and with the public before they approach the regulator. It was my experience when I was with SIA that very often proponents did do that. So the questioner is onto the right path. That proponents with a lot of experience tended to do that anyway. And regulators did encourage them to do it. Couldn't require them to do it, but did encourage them.
One more here, yeah.
Yeah, it's Lee again. I have a supplemental which is directly applicable to both previous speakers. If we take FPIC seriously, free, prior, and informed consent, I've worked on it, I don't know, 10 years ago or something at IFC. The International Finance Corporation is the private sector arm of the World Bank. They actually implemented it as a requirement on their projects. I forget the exact date, 2003, something like that. The first two or three were pretty rough because they really had to squeeze and massage and work really hard to get it through. But my understanding, I haven't worked on these projects in the last couple of years, but my understanding is that it's working pretty well now. It has to be taken literally. It has to be free, it has to be prior, and it has to be informed, and it has to be consent. If we do all that, so much of the rest of this stuff just evaporates. It's exactly what Louise was saying. If the people who get their projects are talking to the communities that are gonna be impacted first. In fact, they're building them into their design process. Figuring out what the problems are and designing around those problems or designing the problems away. So free, prior, informed consent, which is an UNDRIP requirement as well. I mean, all these things come together. Look at the leap that I guess Naomi Klein and people were proposing too late in the election to really get discussed. The leap starts with Indigenous communities. That's where we should be starting, with Indigenous communities and ecosystems and free, prior, and informed consent. It's golden from there on. I mean, you'd never have these silly pipeline projects, which are never going to go anyway because of the price of oil. Oil is never going back up above what it's at now. Everybody knows that. Renewables are now the future. Renewables are now competitive with fossil fuel projects. So they're done. Big oil is done. Rockefeller's pulled out 2 years ago. We know big oil is off. Big fossil has gone. So let's not worry about these pipelines, but let's just think about these other things that we need to design EA to do the way it was meant to do originally. And we can, if we get FPIC and we get ecosystem focus for the sustainability, if we read Bob Gibson, who figured this out 10 years ago, there's a new version of his book coming out. It's all there for us to do. We just have to bite the bullet and this time actually do it. Thanks to everybody. This has been a wonderful event.
My chapter for that book is still cooking away. I think I saw one more question here. Yes, and then we'll go back to the panel for some final comments.
There's been some talk that the NEB doesn't have the jurisdiction to consider upstream and downstream impacts because it's something that's already regulated by the provinces. And this would therefore impinge on provincial jurisdiction. I'm wondering if you could speak to the strength of this argument. Thank you.
Stephen Hazell. Sorry, go ahead, David.
No, I was just saying, I'll leave that to you guys.
Well, my view, it has no strength at all. The NEB under Section 52, which sets out its mandate in assessing pipeline applications, it's very much a public interest mandate. It's a broad public interest mandate. The board has chosen to limit the sorts of things that it considers. That's a decision that the NEB has made. Whatever the province does, I've already spoken about provincial authority in these matters. It's quite limited, but the board has, in my view, comprehensive authority to look at the national public interest. And that includes upstream GHGs, downstream GHGs, whatever it feels is relevant. It just, the board has chosen not to do that.
Just to follow up, I know in the Act, the NEB Act, the words directly linked in terms of the things that we consider. Do you think that term affects the scope of things that can be considered, such as GHGs? Do you think that's something that would have to be removed from the Act? Or once again, do you think that's just the NEB using certain tools in the Act to choose what it wants to include or exclude? Thank you.
Right. Okay, now that's a good point. My view is that as the board's mandate is plenty broad enough to consider upstream and downstream impacts as being directly related. But having said that, I think we really do need to look at that Section 52 clause. If we want the National Energy Board to really be serious about sustainability, that should be right there in black and white in Section 52 as the top thing that it should be considering. Now, I'm not sure. I'm not sure that the National Energy Board should have anything to do with environmental assessment. Maybe, as Andrew says, it just should stick to do market assessments and then leave it to some other agency, the Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency or whatever, to look at overall sustainability questions. But to the extent that NEB is going to, that we want the NEB to be looking at sustainability issues, it should be written into Section 52. And I agree with you that directly related language probably needs to be looked at too.
See, another legacy of C38. I'm going to final round, just ask for some final comments from our panelists if they have any, and then we should wrap. David, any final thoughts?
Well, it's interesting. I guess I'm kind of in the camp of wanting to see Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency restored to its former glory with its own legislation that actually works effectively. So that they would be the ones carrying the ball on these things. And I've been thinking as people have been talking about, you know, we used to have CEARC, whatever that stood for, the Canadian Environmental Assessment Research Council, maybe. That did a lot of good work. And maybe I'm just old now, but I think something like that, which is a real forum for the kinds of discussions that the intelligent panelists, I feel like my intelligence is just draining away since I entered politics. The other panelists would have a great opportunity to engage and try and advance the thinking on environmental assessment in this country to improve the process and the legislation overall as we go along, and not depending simply on the wonderful wisdom of Bob Gibson in his book. Thanks, everyone, for listening. I appreciate the invitation. Really do.
Thank you, David. Stephen, any final comments?
Yes, I think that in terms of I think we let this panel review process play out, and maybe we'll get some good answers from that group. I do think that sustainability has to be at the core of what we're trying to achieve. We have to move beyond environmental assessment as it has been conceived and implemented so far. So let's look at it as a broad sustainability assessment issue. I think there's a paper that really speaks to this, and Gibson was part of it, but also John Sinclair and Meinhard Doyle from Dow. They've written a wonderful paper, and I just recommend that everybody take a look at it. I think it'd be quite instructive.
Anna, last word to you.
Yeah, thanks. I think a lot of the questions that people have been asking have really been pointing at the need for a fundamental systemic change in EA. So again, I'd really like to emphasize how strategic environmental assessment can play a role in addressing a lot of these issues of how to, you know, better involve Indigenous governments, and then how to better involve the public and have these bigger picture questions asked, not at the project level, but before project proposals even hit the table. We need to be linking assessment with planning, with bigger ideas. And then also the need, and this is, again, we need a fundamental shift in EA, because we need decision-making and reviews to be held in independent bodies. We need to have a lot more accountability and transparency in decision-making. And, you know, having a regulator that has historically had a pretty limited focus on just those sort of costs analyses, it's not the best place to be looking at these bigger picture, more policy related questions, and then also at the more technical aspects of environmental effects. So hopefully through this process, we'll be able to crack open some of those bigger questions and get some kind of new, I think, as Bob Gibson and John Sinclair and Meinhard have called it, a next generation environmental assessment law.
Very good. Thank you very much. I want to join me in thanking all of our panelists. I mean, the comments were very, very informative. I also want to thank students Adrian, Joseph, Kristen, Adam, Thomas, and Sophia for their contributions and helping to pull all this together. It's worked out really, really well. Thank you. Very good. So we can sign off. I just saw a request. We'll send around the reference for Meinhard, Bob, and John Sinclair's paper on the future of EA, and we will post the video for this as soon as we have it. And stay tuned. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.